Right, people, here we are bringing in to you the second video of animal classification. Again, a vast chapter, a lot of things to remember. The unfortunate part here is most of the processes we are not aware of, the animal processes which are basically forming the basis of classification. Most of this is fairly covered in the lower standards, but most of these we are not aware of. Okay, so we need to have a little bit of idea of the various functional systems on which classification has been done for animals, and at the same time simultaneously study on the basis of these classifications what are the basic phyla or the kingdoms in which they are actually grouped. So this is the second video. Of course, we will be covering a number of slides out here and trying to start off with the first kingdom, that is sponges. Okay, so before we start off, we need to have a little background of how the attempts were made by various scientists to classify animals. Okay, so classification of animals, this was done by Aristotle, and that was way before. The first attempt was made by Aristotle, more of a philosopher than the scientist. However, a significant contribution made during his times, 384 to 322 BC, that's even before Christ, divided animals into two main groups. The first thing that he divided was anima. Anima, that is, this group includes animals without red blood. So he actually said that there were animals which have red blood and there are animals which do not have red blood. Okay, so that was the basis of classification by Aristotle. So this group includes animals without the red blood, example sponges, then we have cnidaria, then we have mollusca, arthropoda, echinodermata, etc. We know that it is not true that they do not have red blood, but circulatory system, if it is not absent, if it is not present, obviously they will not have red blood. Okay, so that was anima. The other one was enaima. This group includes animals with red bloods, example vertebrates. So all vertebrates. So this was the first attempt that was made to classify animals on the basis of the color of the blood that these animals basically possess. Okay, all right, moving on to the next slide we have here. So this is the most significant classification, that is Whittaker's classification. And Whittaker's classification, we will study, we have studied it in previous standards as well. It is a five kingdom classification. So I read Whittaker basically made an attempt of classifying animals, and this was the most significant as well as the most accepted one till date. This classification was made in 1969, not very earlier times. An American taxonomist divided all the organisms into five kingdoms. As the viruses are on the borderline of living and non-living, they have been left out. So we know that viruses can lie dormant for thousands of years, maybe millions of years, and all of a sudden they become active on getting a host body. So obviously in the entire scientific community there is a debate whether these can be considered as living organisms or non-living organisms. So viruses have been left out from this classification. Okay, Whittaker's five kingdom classification includes Monera, Protista, Plantae, Fungi. So all these are basically included, and these are included in the entire, and animals, of course, this is missing here. Monera, Protista, Plantae, Fungi, and animals. Okay, so these are the five kingdom classifications that we have. So if we look at it, this is basically kingdom Animalia. So this will be Monera, Protista, Plantae, Fungi, I'm sorry, it is missing out here, and kingdom Animalia. Okay, so these are the five kingdoms that we have. If we look at it, the kingdom Animalia, which is the multicellular kingdom, the level of organization we have studied at the start of this chapter, what is level of organization. We have cellular level of organization, we have tissue level of organization, we have basically organ system level of organization, then we have organisms. So level of organization, when it is only at a cellular level, we have the phylum Porifera. So body cavity or colon, symmetry, all these are taken into consideration. Cellular level we have Porifera. Okay, at the tissue or the organ or the organ system level, we have system, we have symmetry as radial and bilateral. Here in sponges, as we have seen, sponges do not have a symmetry. Most of the sponges will not have a symmetry. Okay, so symmetry is absent in sponges, which are animals only at the cellular level. They have still not come to a level of tissues. Okay, the moment we come to tissue or the organ system level, we have radial level of symmetry and then we have bilateral level of symmetry. So in radial level of symmetry, we have cnidaria, which is also known as collentrata, and then we have enophora. Okay, so these are there. Bilateral level of symmetry without gulaem, that is platyhelminthes, that is acolymates, these do not have body cavity at all. With false gulaem, which is basically pseudogulaemates, that is ascahelminthes, or which are also known as nemathelminthes. And with true gulaem, that is cloemates, annelida, orthopoda, mollusca, echinodermata, hemichordata and chordata, most of the entire animal kingdom basically will have a true body cavity. Okay, so this is the kingdom Animalia which we have as per Whittaker. Okay, now phylum Enophora and phylum Echinodermata are exclusively marine animals. So we have to take care of these things as well. So these are exclusively marine, that is they are not found in fresh water or even in terrestrial formats. Okay, Karyopsis taxonomy, karyotaxonomy is based on the number of chromosomes. Okay, obviously this is cytokinesis and karyokinesis. We know cytokinesis is basically division of nucleus, and karyokinesis is division of nucleus, and cytokinesis is basically division of cells. Okay, so karyotaxonomy is based on the number of chromosomes. Obviously it will be related to the nucleus, and nucleus is related to the number of chromosomes as well. Okay, biological species concept was introduced by Ernest Mayr, and that too in 1942. So this was the biological species that was introduced at that point of time. Okay, so the term new systematics was, these are certain histories which we need to correlate with, because if you look into all competitive examinations somewhere or the other in different formats, the names of scientists, discoverers and inventors have been asked very frequently. Okay, so we need to be a little careful about studying and skipping these parts. Okay, the term new systematics was proposed by Sir Julian Huxley, and that was in 1940s. What is basically a cladodic egg? So these are certain terms that we need to be running parallelly while studying animal classification. Okay, egg of terrestrial animal, that is bird and insects. So this is basically egg of a terrestrial animal that may be of a bird or might be of an insect, enclosed within protective shell, enclosed within permitting shell, permitting gaseous exchange. So the gaseous exchange will happen, however this is basically under a protective shell, that is cladodic egg. So eggs of basically terrestrial animals inclusive of birds and insects. Okay, okay, let's move on to a little bit more of history. So the names of the books and the authors that we have, what were the books that were significantly written for classification, and the names of the authors associated with it. So we have Historia Animalium, that was written by Aristotle. We have Systema Naturae, that is basically Linnaeus. Historia Naturalis, that is Pliny. And Historia Naturae, that is Georges Buffon. Okay, so these are basically certain scientists on and their contributions, or basically the books that we have that they have written regarding classification. Okay, so that sums it up all. Okay, now what do we start with? We start with the kingdom of Porifera kingdom. Okay, that is the sponges, the kingdom of the sponges. The sponges, pore bearing animals. Why do we call them as Porifera? Because they have pores inside their bodies, or rather outside their bodies as well. So John Ellis, that is in 1765, first recognized sponges as animals. He was the first one to actually recognize or give the recognition of animals to sponges. Okay, Robert Grant in 1825 finally proved animal nature of sponges and gave them the name Porifera. So he was the first person who actually finally proved and gave them the name Porifera. Study of sponges is called parazoology. So the entire study of sponges is called parazoology. Okay, general characteristics of sponges, talking about their habitat, all sponges are aquatic. Most of the sponges are aquatic, mostly marine. Mostly the sponges will be found in marine water, that is salty water, saline water. Okay, rarely fresh water. Spongella is a rare species of sponges that is found in fresh water. Okay, solitary or colonial, they can exist as solitary patches or they can form a colony, and when they form a colony they become a great attraction to the tourists. We know the Great Barrier Reef in Australia is a huge attraction for the tourists. Okay, solitary or colonial, They can be sessile, that is attached to the substratum. They can be sessile, that is attached, just like plants are. Okay, sponges, they like warmer water, and ocean water, sea water is comparatively warmer water. They are not usually found in cold waters. Okay, so we will not find them. We will not find them in places where there is a possibility of snow formation or where there is a possibility of temperatures going significantly low. Okay, they are generally found in warm waters. What is their body form? Their body is porous, generally very porous, provided with pores. The pores are of two types. Inhalant pores called ostia, that is single ostium. There are inhalant pores and exhalant pores, that is known as oscula. Inhalant pores through which the things come in, and exhalant pores are the ones through which the things go out, mostly the waste part and all. Exhalant pores are known as oscula. Okay, singular, we will call them as osculum. The inhalant pores will be known as ostia. The singular part is ostium. Okay, symmetry, most of the sponges are symmetrical. Mostly they are symmetrical. Some are radially symmetrical. Some can be divided on the basis of, we have seen earlier in the earlier video, what basically is symmetry, what is radial symmetry, what is bilateral symmetry. So symmetry is basically a form of in which we classify animals. Okay, germ layers, we have discussed about germ layers. There are three germ layers: endoderm, ectoderm and mesoderm. Okay, these two are out of them, only ectoderm and endoderm is basically present in sponges. Okay, so they are hence diploblastic. The sponges are the first multicellular diploblastic animals. So these are diploblastic animals derived only from two embryonic germ layers, that is ectoderm and endoderm. Okay, let's talk about the level of the organization. The sponges have cellular level of organization. First is body wall. The body wall of a common sponge consists of three layers. So the body wall will be made up of three layers. The first layer is pinacoderm. Okay, pinacoderm, that is the dermal layer. It is outer cellular layer which consists of flattened pinacocytes. So we have basically, see, if we look into this, this is basically the pinacoderm. This is the pinacoderm. Okay, the pinacoderm is a dermal layer. It is the outer layer which consists of flattened pinacocytes. So these are, if you see, these are flattened cells, and these are also known as pinacocytes. Okay, then we have oval porocytes. We have oval porocytes. If we look into this, we will have porocytes here. If we see here, porocytes, the pores through which things go in. So these are oval porocytes, oval shaped porocytes. Then the second layer is coanoderm, that is the gastral layer. This is the coanoderm. It is inner cellular layer which consists of highly specialized flagellated cells called coanocytes or collar cells. So let's look at this. Here we have the coanocytes, specialized layers, and they are flagellated. If you look into this, they are having flagellas out here. So these are flagellated. Okay, coanoderm. And this is a gastral layer. It is inner cellular layer which consists of highly specialized flagellated cells called coanocytes or collar cells. So these are known as coanocytes or collar cells. Okay, what do we have next here? Both pinacoderm and coanoderm do not have basement membrane. So if you look into it, both pinacoderm, this is basically the pinacoderm, and the coanoderm, this is the coanoderm part. Okay, if you look into this, this is the coanoderm. This, from here the coanoderm starts and it is flagellated. They do not have any basement membranes. Both pinacoderm and coanoderm will not have any basement membranes. Okay, mesophyll layer. Okay, this is known as mesenchyme. Basically it is a non-cellular layer found in between pinacoderm and coanoderm. It has fine dispersal spongin fibers and numerous spicules. So spicules are thorn like if you look at this, if you see, these are spicules. Okay, this is the mesophyll layer. This is the mesophyll layer between the pinacoderm and the coanoderm. These are the coanocytes, these are the pinacoderm, this is the pinacoderm layer, and in between we have the mesophyll layer. So in the mesophyll we will see that there are certain spicules out there. Okay, found between pinacoderm and coanoderm. It has fine dispersal spongin fibers and numerous spicules. So these are spicules which are there and spongin fibers. It also contains amoebocytes. Now what are amoebocytes basically? These are amoeba-like cells, not amoeba in fact. They are amoeba-like cells of both pinacoderm and choanoderm. Okay, so this will contain amoebocytes. Okay, these are basically the amoebocytes that have, see if you look at it, here there is amoeba-like structures. So these are amoebocytes. These are amoebocytes which are present. Spongin fibers are also present in the mesophyll area. Spongin fibers are present, okay. It also contains amoebocytes, amoeba-like cells of both pinacoderm and choanoderm. Okay, amoebocytes are modified into the following cells. First, we will call them as archaeocytes. Archaeocytes are what? They may be converted into other types of cells and are also called undifferentiated totipotent cells. So totipotency means that there is a chance of getting converted into other type of cells. So these are also known as totipotent cells. Archaeocytes are also known as totipotent cells. If you look into this, these are basically archaeocytes out here. Archaeocytes, and these have the in this spongin fibers we will have archaeocytes, and these are totipotent cells. So that is one category of amoebocytes. What else do we have here? Oh my god, what happened here? Okay, tropocytes provide food to the developing cells and are called as nurse cells. So first is archaeocytes. Amoebocytes can be classified into archaeocytes, which can be modified into the other form of cells, and hence they are known as totipotent cells. And then we have trophocytes, okay, which provide food to the developing cells and are called as nurse cells. So these are basically providing food to the other cells, and they are also known as nurse cells. Then we have the third form of amoebocyte, that is thesocytes. They store food granules. So the entire amoebocytes can be divided into three: archaeocytes, which can be converted into other form of cells, and they are also known as totipotent cells. Then we have trophocytes, okay, which provide food to the developing cells and hence are also called as nurse cells. And then we have thesocytes that store food granules. Thesocytes basically will store food granules. Then we have gland cells. These secrete a slimy substance. Okay. Then we have colonocytes. Colonocytes secrete spongin fibers of the mesophyll layer. So we have seen that there are spongin fibers, and these spongin fibers are secreted by the colonocytes. So gland cells, they will secrete a slimy substance, and colonocytes, they secrete spongin fibers of the mesophyll layer. Then we have scleroblasts secrete spicules in calcareous sponges. They are called calcioblasts. These are basically known as calcioblasts. So we have seen what spicules look like in the earlier slide. So these are the what is happening? Why is it getting delayed? So we have seen the spicules part out here, wherein spicules are present, and they will basically, these are the spicules that are present here. Okay, let's move on. Okay, so this is basically the flagellum. This is the choanocyte. Here we have the cytoplasm. Then we have the cell membrane. Inside there is a nucleus. This is basically parabasal body. Then we have rhizoplast. Then we have baroplast, and then we have a chloral. So this is basically the flagellum that is there. Okay. So let's move on. So mycocytes. What are the mycocytes? They form a circular ring around the osculum. What is the osculum? The exhalant part, from where the things go out. Okay, osculum will help in loosing and opening of the osculum. So osculum will loosen and then open out, and it will let the things go out which are not required. Okay, germ cells, which are also known as the sex cells, forms sperms and ova and develop during breeding season. So there is a specific breeding season during which germ cells will develop, and hence the sex cells will develop. Then we have the chromocytes. They contain pigment granules and excretory substances. They contain the pigment granules, and they will also contain excretory substances. Okay. Phagocytes, we all know what are they. They collect food from choanocytes through their pseudopodia and also engulf excreta and damaged tissues. So anything which is damaged and anything which can prove toxic or detrimental to the life of sponges is actually consumed by phagocytes, pretty much similar to the functions that they perform in human bodies as well. Okay, so this is a part of the porifera kingdom. Porifera will be primarily sponges, and we will deal more with it in the next slide. Till then, stay tuned. Any questions, please feel free to post in the comments and ask and clarify. Anything more that you would like to get uploaded on biology, please feel free to comment on the comment section. Okay. Thank you so much for watching the video.